Good evening, everybody, and welcome to our service this Easter Sunday evening. If you're visiting with us, then you're very welcome indeed. And perhaps some of you are here because this is a special service of baptism and of admission to membership of our fellowship here. It's always a great joy, a great encouragement when we have a service like this, and it's a great testimony to the power of the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. This is Easter Sunday. Let me read some words from the Apostle Paul. He says, "If in this life only we, that is, we Christians, have hoped in Christ, then we are of all people most to be pitied. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For as by man came death, by a man has come also the resurrection from the dead. For as in Adam all die, so also in Christ shall all be made alive, but each in its own order, Christ the first fruits, and then at his coming, those who belong to Christ." This is the Christian faith. This is the Christian hope. And so we begin this evening by singing a great Easter hymn, "Jesus Lives. Your terrors now can, O death, no more appall us." Well, do be seated, and as we sit, let's join our hearts together in prayer. Let's pray. Our great and gracious Heavenly Father, it's with great gladness and joy and with hearts full of song that we bow in your presence this Sunday evening as we remember the great joy of that first Easter day when the Lord Jesus Christ rose from the dead, was seen, was touched, when his wandering disciples began at first to compute, to understand that death's darkness had been broken, that a new day had dawned, that the beginning of the future that he had promised was already seen in his risen flesh and blood, the grave robbed of its power, death stripped of its fear, of its agony, and of its hopelessness. And so, Lord, today, all over this world, men and women of every tribe and tongue and people and nation have gathered and will gather as we gather here tonight to sing your praise in the name of Jesus Christ, your Son, our great Savior, the risen Lord, and to long for his appearing, for his coming, when at last he who is the first fruits will be seen to have won a great, a bountiful harvest of a multitude that no man can ever number of those who belong to Christ and who on that day will be raised from their graves to stand victorious with him and to rejoice in his presence forever and ever. This is the hope, Lord, in which we are saved. This is the faith that we proclaim. And this it is that brings joy to our hearts this Eastertide. And so as we gather this evening to hear your word, to sing your praise, to welcome with joy and gladness numbers into our fellowship here through profession of faith in Jesus your Son, we ask, Lord, that you would be pleased to be in our midst. And by your Holy Spirit, the Spirit of the risen Lord Jesus himself, you would fill our hearts with joy and with praise, with faith, with trusting, with a knowledge of the Father in the face of Jesus Christ, and send us on our way, renewed, strengthened, restored, made resilient to live for him and for his gospel all the days of our lives. So hear us, Lord, draw near to us, we pray, as we come to you in faith and in trust. So open our eyes and open our hearts to know you and to love you. For we ask it in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Well, we're going to sing another hymn of Easter praise that speaks once again of the victory of our Lord Jesus Christ. The strife is past, the battle done. Now is the victor's triumph won. We're going to turn to our Bibles now, and if you turn with me to the New Testament and to Peter's second letter. Edward began last Sunday evening a series in this second letter of Peter, and we're going to read again in chapter 1, beginning at verse 1 through to verse 15. I'll read in English, and then one of our brothers is going to come and read also in Farsi, so that our Farsi speakers can understand fully the passage before us tonight. So first Peter then, second Peter, chapter 1 and verse 1. Simeon Peter, a servant and apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who have obtained a faith of equal standing with ours by the righteousness of our God and Savior Jesus Christ, may grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. His divine power has granted us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of him who called us to his own glory and excellence, by which he has granted to us his precious and very great promises, so that through them you may become partakers of the divine nature, having escaped from the corruption that is in the world because of sinful desire. For this very reason, make every effort to supplement your faith with virtue, and virtue with knowledge, and knowledge with self-control, and self-control with steadfastness, and steadfastness with godliness, and godliness with brotherly affection, and brotherly affection with love. For if these qualities are yours and are increasing, they keep you from being ineffective or unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. For whoever lacks these qualities is so nearsighted that he is blind, having forgotten that he was cleansed from his former sins. Therefore, brothers, be all the more diligent to make your calling and election sure. For if you practice these qualities, you will never fall. For in this way there will be richly provided for you an entrance into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Therefore, I intend always to remind you of these qualities, though you know them and are established in the truth that you have. I think it right, as long as I am in this body, to stir you up by way of reminder, since I know that the putting off of my body will be soon, as our Lord Jesus Christ made clear to me. And I will make every effort so that after my departure, you may be able at any time to recall these things. And I will have the reading also in Farsi.
برادران کتاب مقدس رو باز کنن صفحه 1601 صفحه 1601 نامه پتروس رسول آیه 5 تا 11 از همین رو به سعی تمام بکوشید تا به واسطه ایمان خود نیکویی بار آورید و به واسطه نیکویی شناخت و به واسطه شناخت خیشتنداری و به واسطه خیشتنداری پایداری و به واسطه پایداری دینداری و به واسطه دینداری مهر برادرانه و به واسطه مهر برادرانه محبت زیرا چون اینها در شما باشد و فزونی یابد نخواهد گذاشت در شناخت خداوند ما عیسی مسیح بیفایده و بیثمر باشید اما آن که آری از اینهاست کور است و کوته بین و از یاد برده که از گناهان گذشته خیش پاک شده است. پس ای برادران، هرچی بیشتر بکوشید تا با فراخواندگی و برگزیدگی خیش را ثابت و تثبیت نمایید. زیرا که اگر چنین کنید، هرگز سقوط نخواهید کرد. زیرا این چنین دخول به پادشاهی جاودان خداوند و نجاتنده ما عیسی مسیح به فراوانی به شما عطا خواهد شد. آمین.
Thank you, Rasul. Well, we're going to have just now our offering, and while we do that, the little choir that Matt had together for the Easter concert last Saturday were so good that we thought that it would be a shame for all of us not to at least to have a little taste of their performance. And so while the offering's taken up, the choir is going to come and sing to us a lovely piece. And are you going to introduce it, Matt? No, he's not. Well, come on, bring your people up. Come on, stand up. Come. They're going to sing God So Loved the World, which is the most beautiful piece from Stainer's Crucifixion. And as a choir sing, the offering will be received. Well, let's join our heart together in prayer. Let's pray. Lord, as we hear these words sung, and they remind us of the depth of your wonderful love for this world, you so loved a world in rebellion, in sin, in darkness, in refusal of you. You sent your only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. How we marvel at the depths of your grace and the breadth of your great love. And so we ask, Lord, that as we come to study your word together this evening, you would fill us afresh with its message of joy and gladness, of hope, and of challenge and encouragement, that we should live every day all the more for the one who has so loved us. So help us, we pray. For Jesus' sake, amen. Before Edward comes to preach to us then, we sing again the hymn on the screens, a version of part of the 119th Psalm, The Will of God to Mark My Way, the Word of God for Light.
Just giving the music a little chance to die down. Good. Well, friends, let's turn in our Bibles to 2 Peter chapter 1. And I think you'll find this on page 1018 in our church Bibles. 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 to 11. And my title for this evening is Making Your Calling and Election Sure. Now, a service like this, in which we admit new members to the congregation, is always a very happy occasion. Once you've become a member, your name is on the roll. It's there in black and white. You've been admitted. You're a member of the Tron Church. And you don't doubt that, and nobody doubts it. But can we be quite so sure that we are members of God's eternal kingdom? Can we be certain that our names are on his eternal roll? Just look at verse 11 in our passage. For in this way there will be richly provided for you an entrance into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Can we be sure about that? Can we have the same certainty about our eternal membership as we can about our membership of the congregation? Well, the Apostle Peter says, yes, we can, and that's what our passage for this evening is all about. It's really important for Christian people to be sure about this, because if we haven't got a firm grip on the Bible's teaching about our sure and certain membership of God's eternal kingdom, we shall remain underdeveloped and insecure, hesitant in bearing witness about Christ. We shall lack boldness and lack in the sheer happiness which is such a central element in the Bible's teaching about the Christian life. Now, it's verses 5 to 11 that I particularly want us to dig into this evening. But before we look at those verses, let's take a bird's eye view of what Peter the Apostle is wanting his readers to grasp in the whole section from verse 3 to verse 11. Now, the key verse in this section, the verse that Peter is really driving towards throughout the whole paragraph, is verse 10. Therefore, brothers. Now, whenever a verse begins like that, you know that the writer is driving his nail home. Therefore, brothers, be all the more diligent to make your calling and election sure. For if you practice these qualities, you will never fail, never fall. Now, that's the key verse. And you'll see that it's a command that takes its force from what the apostle has been saying in the foregoing verses. Now, there's a striking phrase in verse 10 there. These qualities. And that's a phrase he repeats in verse 12. Therefore, I intend always to remind you of these qualities. And if you look back to verse 8, you'll see it there again. For if these qualities are yours and are increasing, they will keep you from being ineffective. And the same phrase comes again in verse 9. So what are these qualities? They are the 8 qualities that Peter describes in verses 5, 6, and 7. Faith, virtue, knowledge, self-control, steadfastness, godliness, brotherly affection, and love. And you'll see that that list of qualities is headed by a command at the beginning of verse 5. For this very reason, make every effort to supplement your faith with virtue, virtue with knowledge, and so on. So that list of desirable qualities, commanded in verse 5, described in verses 5, 6, and 7, referred to again in verse 8 and verse 9, pressed upon the reader in verse 10, and re-emphasized in verse 12, these qualities are clearly Peter's main concern in this part of his letter. They are of central importance. And verse 10 is clearly saying that if the readers will practice these qualities, they will never fall, and they will make their calling and election sure. Now, friends, a penny for your thoughts. Are you thinking, well, surely the Apostle Peter is at odds here with the Apostle Paul? Doesn't Paul teach that justification comes through faith and not through works? But Peter seems to be saying that it's all about effort. Try very hard and you'll get there. Doesn't he say in verse 5, supplement your faith with these 7 other things, 7 grunt qualities over which we are to make every effort? If faith has to be supplemented with 7 other things before we can be sure about our calling and election, it's not justification by faith alone. It looks much more like salvation through a lot of hard work. Now, it's at a point like this where we suddenly feel baffled that we need to remind ourselves of what Peter has been saying back in verses 3 and 4. It's so easy to misunderstand a Bible passage if we don't read it in its context. Look at how verse 5 begins. For this very reason, make every effort. So the grunt work is based upon prior facts. And those facts are the two great grants or gifts that God has already given to all Christians, without which we couldn't even begin to live the Christian life. You could sum the whole thing up like this: that divine provision is the precondition of human effort. Look again at verse 3 and 4. Two gifts. The first gift or grant described in verse 3 is the grant of all things that pertain to life and godliness. Everything that enables you and me to live a godly life is granted to us by God's divine power. So the origin of all this is heavenly, it's not human. And then what is the second grant? It's there in verse 4. He has granted to us his precious and very great promises. And that means that he has given to us not simply bare promises, but also the things promised. And in verse 4, he especially mentions the ability to escape from the world's corrupting influence by partaking of the divine nature. In other words, by becoming God's children and beginning to share and reproduce his own characteristics. So it means that this human effort that Peter is calling his readers to in verses 5, 6, and 7 is impossible without God's prior provision. Divine provision is the precondition of human effort. Now, this is exactly what the Apostle Paul teaches. Think of his letter to the Ephesians in chapter 2, for example. He says to his readers, "You were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked." He doesn't mean physically dead, he means spiritually dead. Now, if you're dead, you can't be commanded to rise up. You can't respond to anything. But Paul goes on in Ephesians 2, "But God, being rich in mercy, made us, who were corpses, alive together with Christ." And it's only then, on that basis of God's prior life-giving action, that Paul goes on to urge the Ephesian Christians to express the Christian faith in godly living. And the Apostle James makes just the same kind of point in his opening chapter, in James chapter 1. He says, "Of his own will, God brought us forth by the word of truth." In other words, caused us to be born again. And it's only on that basis that James then urges his readers to live a godly life. And he goes on to say that faith, apart from works, is dead. So to return to 2 Peter chapter 1, it's important that we see the order in which Peter describes the Christian life. What comes first is God's action, God's power, his divine power, as verse 3 puts it. Allied to which is the giving of his precious and very great promises, which bring about the new birth and enable us to become partakers of the divine nature. And it's only once we've understood these wonderful prior gifts of God that Peter then issues his command in verse 5, "For this very reason, because we now partake of the divine nature, because we've been granted all things that pertain to life and godliness, for this reason, make every effort to supplement your faith with the lovely qualities listed in verses 5 to 7. So do you see how the order is crystal clear? New birth first by the power of God, and then growth in godly living and godly effort. Now, friends, let me ask this. Have you grasped this order? If you haven't, you'll be in a muddle about the security of your salvation. The Bible's teaching, the whole Bible's teaching, which lies behind these verses, is that God chooses or elects those who will come to Christ, and he takes all the initiative. Now, we don't know why he chooses some and not others. Those questions are hidden within his own counsel. But he does this before we are born. He did it before the world was created. And his choice does not rest upon our merits. Far from it. As you know, some of the world's most violent and unpleasant people become Christians. I'm sure he wouldn't mind me saying this, but I think, for example, of Ramraj David, who's one of the senior leaders of the Delhi Bible Institute. As an angry young man 20 or 30 years ago, he was the commander of a Red Brigade communist unit in northern India and did all sorts of wrong things. He was then wonderfully converted, and he's now planting churches and training pastors all across North India. He didn't deserve God's mercy. He had no claim upon God to give him the new birth. Neither did I, and neither do you. All of us have been hard-hearted God opponents in the past. All of us once had no room for God. We despised godliness. We thought of the church as a peculiar museum piece. And if people spoke to us about becoming Christians or being saved, we thought they were soft in the head. But if you're a Christian today, God elected you before you were born, and he called you. And then he opened your ear to the gospel. He gave you ears to hear it and a heart to understand how Christ had died for you. And then you came to Christ, humbled to the core of your being. And then you got down on your knees and you thanked him for having mercy on a sinner like you who had defied his authority and rejected his love. And then you realized that you were born again, born into a new world where Christ is king. In Peter's words, that you are now a partaker of the divine nature, that the very nature of God was beginning to refashion your very thinking and your values. Now, it's those who don't understand this gospel who think that human effort has to come first. Try hard, people think. Do good. Keep your nose clean. And God might accept you in the end if you don't blot your copybook too badly. Now, that's always the approach of unregenerate man. It's the approach of all the world's religious faiths, except for the gospel. It's only Christianity that shows us the wonder of undeserved and prior grace. Grace to the sinner, mercy and forgiveness to the God rejecter. Peter is so clear about the order of things here. First, in verse 3, comes God's divine power, which has made us a grant of all we need to live a godly life. Along with that blessing come his promises in verse 4, promises not only given, but delivered upon, so that we can have and experience now his divine nature at work in our own natures, reshaping us to reproduce the likeness of Christ in us. And it's for this very reason, verse 5, that the apostle now commands his readers to make every effort to supplement the faith, which is the basis of the Christian life, with these seven other qualities. So this is not salvation by works. This is salvation by calling and election, by divine power and glorious promises from God, in response to all of which we then learn to make every effort. Well, let's move on now as we try to grasp the apostles' teaching. I don't want to spend long on these seven qualities here, but we will look at them briefly. Faith comes first in verse 5. That's the basis of our whole relationship with the Lord. And you'll see that love comes last as the climax of the list. Love in this context, not so much for God as love for other people. Then after faith, Peter starts with virtue, by which he means an energy of goodness, something proactive that throws itself into the Christian life with enthusiasm and joy. Next, there's knowledge. Above all, knowledge of God, both knowing him and knowing about him. Peter speaks of this knowledge in chapter 1, verse 2, and again in the very last verse of the whole letter. Now, the source of this knowledge of God, is, of course, the Bible, not our thick heads or our silly imaginations. Next, there comes self-control. And self-control is right at the heart of all the ethical teaching of the Bible. It means self-discipline, learning to control not only the appetites for food and drink and sex and indolence, but also our tendencies to speak rashly, to grumble, to become angry, and to throw our weight around. Next, there's steadfastness, the ability to persevere through thick and thin, trusting the Lord as much when the road is uphill as when the road is level and easy. Then there's godliness. One of my commentaries defines this as a very practical awareness of God in every aspect of life. I quite like that, in every aspect of life. You're walking the dog, let's say, but you're very much aware of the Lord. You're ironing your husband's shirt or your wife's trousers, but you're still thinking glad thoughts of the Lord. Your life becomes infiltrated at every level with thoughts of truth and gospel and the world to come. You're often thinking about these things. Next comes brotherly affection. Philadelphia is the word in the Greek, and that means learning to love and rejoice in your Christian brothers and sisters, especially those who are very different humanly, different in nationality or color or educational background or temperament. The extrovert learning to appreciate the introvert. The shy person learning to talk to the irrepressible optimist. Philadelphia, that's one of the great joys of the Christian life. And then finally, love. Love not just for Christians, but for all people, and not least for those who are far from God and who so much need the gospel. Now, to help us to see how Peter is dealing with these qualities, let's notice the verb that he uses in verse 5. For this very reason, he says, make every effort to supplement your faith with virtue and so on. That word supplement, it's an important word here. It really means to furnish or to develop or to increase. Let me illustrate what I mean. When I'd been in my first job as a young minister for a few months, the church that I was working with got hold of a council flat for me in a high-rise block in our parish on the edge of Manchester. I'd been lodging with a family there in the church initially, but then this flat became available for me. I was young and unmarried. It was rather exciting. But I didn't have a stick of furniture at that point in my life, not one stick. But just as I was about to move into this flat without a stick of furniture, it happened that an elderly man died in a neighboring flat. Now, the flats in these high-rise blocks were all designed on exactly the same model, all exactly the same size. So the old man's daughter happened to hear that I was moving into the flat very close by, and she phoned me up and she said, do you want my dad's furniture? I've got to clear the flat out. So I said, yes, please, without a moment's hesitation. I'll tell you what I had. There was a fridge, a kitchen table, a cooker, which worked. There were upright chairs, armchairs, a sofa, a carpet. There was the bed that the old man had died in. I took the lot. Well, the bed was fine. It was the old man who'd been ill. So I had all the basics of this flat, and I was able to move in without paying a penny. But the flat still needed to be further furnished out. So as time went on, over the next few months, I got hold of a desk for working at. I got some pictures for the walls, a radio, towels and blankets, a record player for my vinyl LPs, and so on and so forth. So I started with an empty flat, but gradually this empty flat began to be furnished out. Now in verses 5, 6, and 7, Peter is describing a new life, which is like an empty flat, and it then needs to be furnished out. It's God, of course, who has provided the new life. He's given us all we need to enable us to live a godly life. But we now, in the words of verse 5, have to make every effort to furnish out our faith with these seven qualities. And Peter is not asking us to do the impossible. If you're a young Christian, you'll perhaps have only a few sticks of furniture in the flat of your Christian life so far. But when you look at the lives of those who've been Christians for a lot longer than you have, you will see that they have indeed developed these qualities to a much greater degree. They have been making every effort, and that's why you see in them unmistakable signs of steadfastness and self-control and brotherly affection and all these other things. You'll see from verse 8 that these qualities need to be increasing. The Christian life is constantly growing and increasing. That's one of the joys of getting older as a Christian. The Christian life really does get better and better. Now, do you feel that all this is very daunting? Does your heart sink at the thought of making every effort? Do you think to yourself, I want a quiet life. It's hard enough for me just to survive from one week to the next. Don't ask me to get into the spiritual gymnasium. I just want a very quiet gentle Christian life. I don't want to have too many demands made upon me. I wonder if you think like that. Well, if you do, see what Peter says next, and you might just be encouraged to follow his advice. Because what he gives us in the next few verses is three powerful incentives to make every effort to furnish out our lives with the qualities of verses 5 to 7. So let's look at these incentives, these great encouragements to develop the Christian life. First, from verse 8, there's the incentive to be effective and fruitful in our knowledge of the Lord Jesus. Verse 8, for if these qualities are yours and are increasing, they keep you from being ineffective or unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Wouldn't it be sad to get to the end of our life, to be sitting in one of those high back chairs in the old folks' home with your Zimmer frame beside you, looking back over 70 or 80 years and thinking, I have been an idle and undeveloped Christian. I fear that my Christian life has been ineffective and unfruitful. Wouldn't that be sad? Well, Peter is telling us how to be sure that things don't end up that way. If these qualities, he says, are yours and are increasing, you won't be ineffective or unfruitful. Your Christian life will make a real contribution to the strength and growth of the gospel. Isn't that a great incentive to make every effort to furnish out our lives with these qualities? But let's notice something important here. Peter is not saying that the way to be effective and fruitful is to cram our diaries so full that every moment of the week is taken up with Christian meetings and Christian activities. Verses 5, 6, and 7 are not about hyperactivism. They're about the growth of godly character, virtue and knowledge and self-control and steadfastness. Now, of course, the Christian, the committed Christian, will be a busy person. There's always plenty to do. But if it's activism at the expense of the growth of godly character, it's not what Peter is teaching us here. If we're to increase in these qualities, we need time to breathe and think. We need time to discuss with friends how to grow in steadfastness and self-control and brotherly affection. We need time to be able to pray and to read. Overactivism is much more likely to lead to exhaustion and falling into sin than to the growth of godly character. But with that little caution in mind, let's attend to the furnishing of our lives with godly qualities, because the increase of them will keep us from being ineffective or unfruitful. Now, the second incentive that Peter gives us comes in verse 9. For whoever lacks these qualities is so short-sighted that he is blind, having forgotten that he was cleansed from his former sins. Now, who wants to lose both sight and memory, to become blind and forgetful? A person who doesn't press forward to increase in these godly qualities loses his ability to see what his life means. He becomes not only short-sighted, but so short-sighted that he's blind. And in particular, Peter says, he becomes blind to the fact that he has been cleansed from his former sins. And that is the same as saying that he has forgotten the meaning of the gospel. Think of it. If I forget that I've been cleansed from my former sins, it means that I forget why Jesus came. The angel, way back, said to Joseph, "You shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins." But I've forgotten about that. I no longer care about it. John the Baptist said of Jesus, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." But I've forgotten that as well. I've forgotten that the blood of the Passover lambs was sprinkled and daubed on the lintels and doorposts of the Israelites' houses in Egypt, so that the destroying angel should spare them as he passed through the land. I've forgotten that the Passover lambs were slaughtered to teach me the meaning of the slaughter of Jesus. Or then again, Jesus said to the Jewish leaders, "I'm the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep," meaning to save them, to be a sacrifice for them, his life for ours, death for him so that life could be ours, our sins cleansed. But I've forgotten that he laid down his life for me. The gratitude has drained out of my heart. I've become short-sighted to the point of blindness. I can see my life in terms of the physical and transient world that I live in. I eat and I drink and I walk the dog and I pay my bills. But I'm no longer aware of the eternal dimensions of my life. I've become a blind man. I've also forgotten what Peter wrote to me in his first letter, that we were ransomed from the futile ways inherited from our fathers, not with perishable things like silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, like that of a lamb without blemish or spot. Precious blood. But I've forgotten the blood. I've forgotten the value of it. I've forgotten the Lord's sufferings. As verse 9 puts it, I've forgotten that I've been cleansed from my sins, and that means that I no longer care about Jesus. And the point of verse 9 is to urge us to make every effort to furnish out our lives with the godly qualities of verses 5 to 7, because if we lack them, it means that blindness and darkness will descend upon us, and the very heart of the gospel will disappear from our understanding. Isn't that an incentive to obey the command of verse 5? Then Peter's third incentive comes in verses 10 and 11, picking it up halfway through verse 10. For if you practice these qualities, you will never fall, for in this way there will be richly provided for you an entrance into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. J.B. Phillips translates it like this: if you have lived the sort of life I've recommended, God will open wide to you the gates of the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And the point at which the gates are opened wide is the point at which this life ends and the life of the world to come begins. The gates are flung open and you walk through an entrance richly provided. Jesus pictures this so well in one of his parables, where the master says, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You've been faithful over a little. I will set you now over much. Enter into the joy of your master." Now, that's the final goal of the Christian life. That's where it all leads to. Now, I know we have all sorts of proper and good goals during our earthly lives: spreading the gospel, building up the church, encouraging the brothers and sisters. But the great goal is there in verse 11, to leave the United Kingdom and to enter the eternal kingdom, the kingdom where Christ is king. In his prayer to God the Father, just before he died, in John chapter 17, Jesus said this: "Father, I desire that they also whom you have given to me may be with me where I am, to see my glory that you have given me because you loved me before the foundation of the world." Isn't that an extraordinary request? Jesus wants you and me to be with him forever so that we can see him as he is, so that we can share his glory and his reign. That's why he came to earth to die for us. He yearns for our company forever. And that is Peter's incentive, perhaps the greatest of these incentives to us, to make every effort to furnish our lives with godly qualities so that we can rejoice in a richly provided entrance into the kingdom where Christ reigns forever, when the gates are flung wide to welcome us into our true and glorious home. So let's lastly turn to verse 10 and ask exactly what Peter means by it. It is the key verse in this section. Really, you might say it's the key verse of the whole letter. The apostle, who greatly loves the churches, wants their members to be deeply assured that God has called and elected them. "Therefore, brothers," he says in verse 10, "be all the more diligent to make your calling and election sure. For if you practice these qualities, you will never fall." It's the practicing and the increasing of these qualities that will give us deep assurance that we really are called and chosen by God. So let me try and clarify this now in one or two brief points. First, and this is a very important one, the making sure of our calling and election is not a making sure in God's mind, as if he were in doubt about us. What it means is making sure in our minds. God made his choice and election of every Christian before the world was created. He has always known those who are his. It's in our minds that the assurance needs to be secured. And Peter is saying that the diligent application of our efforts to grow in the lifestyle of verses 5 to 7 will bring us to a point where we have no doubts in our minds about God's election of us to membership of his people. Throw yourself into the godly life. That's what Peter is saying. And your doubts about whether you're a Christian will disappear. The sureness, the being sure, that's for our minds, not for God's. He knows already. Then secondly, a person might ask, but isn't it presumptuous for me to say I'm certain that God has chosen me? The answer, friend, is no, not at all. In fact, it's the other way round. It would be presumptuous, in fact, unbelieving, to reject this kind of certainty when God offers it to us. In this passage, we're listening to the voice of God the Father speaking through Simon Peter, pressing upon his children the joy and the certainty of their belonging to him, their calling and election. Just think of this for a moment in human terms. One of the things that every parent wants for their child is that the child should be sure about the relationship between itself and the parent. The little boy knows that even though he's just kicked the football through the kitchen window and shattered it, he's not thrown out of the family. He needs to know that. Oh, he's disciplined, yes, but the security of his place in the family is not threatened. One of the strongest instincts in the human parent is to let the child know, deep down inside, that he or she is loved and belongs permanently. Now, if that's the way that frail men and women think about their children, how much more does our Heavenly Father want us to be sure that we're called and chosen, that we belong forever, that we will be richly provided with an entrance into the eternal kingdom? He loves us. He doesn't want us to be in a doubt about our relationship with him. Thirdly, then, let's muster our energies to obey the command of verse 5, because it's the obeying of the command in verse 5 that produces the assurance of verse 10. Practicing and increasing in these qualities of verses 5 to 7, it's a very practical matter. It's to do with how we actually live. These qualities are all about our relationships, the way we live with each other. Just think for a moment, everybody, of what you can do. What kind of gifts and abilities you have. Think of your capabilities. And whatever those capabilities are, throw them into the life of the church. Everything can be used. What can you do? Let me just list a few things. Admin, IT skills, cleaning, photography, electronics, joinery, painting, baking, making jam. Tending the garden of an elderly church member, especially between April and September when the weeds are growing. How about that? Visiting the elderly, teaching the young, leading at a summer camp, leading Bible studies, encouraging other people, hospitality at home, making people laugh. There are some people who have a ministry of fun. We need it in the church. Supporting the unmarried and the married in times of stress. Listening, making real friendships with those of other nationalities. Advising people out of your professional skills without charging a fee. Now, the list of things we can do for each other, they can go on endlessly, but don't just stand at the edge of the swimming pool, teetering on the brink. Dive in, and you'll find that the Lord won't allow you to sink. But it's in these very practical ways that we exercise virtue and knowledge and steadfastness and brotherly affection and love and all these other qualities. And it's the exercising of all these things that builds up our confidence that we really are called and chosen by God. It's a bit like muscles. If you don't use them, you lose your ability to use them. But the more you exercise them, the more your confidence and ability grows. And inevitably, you become a much more effective and fruitful and joyful Christian. And then lastly, as the assurance of our salvation grows within us, the effect it has on us is to make us not cocky or arrogant, but humble and grateful. To pick up Peter's phrases, when we remember that we have been cleansed from our former sins, when we ponder and consider God's precious and very great promises, when we think of how his grace and kindness, all undeserved, have made us partakers of the divine nature, when we realize that he has enabled us to escape from the corruption that pollutes and defaces the world, and when we think of that richly provided final entrance into the eternal kingdom which is promised to us, how could we be anything but humbled? We've done nothing to deserve it. His calling and election of us is not based on our merits. It's based on his loving purpose, which is ultimately beyond our understanding. But this loving, wonderful Father commands us to make every effort to furnish out our lives with all these godly qualities. And it's for our sake, for the sake of our peace and joy and security, so that we should know for certain that we are members, not just of the Tron congregation, but of his eternal kingdom. Therefore, brothers, be all the more diligent to make your calling and election sure. For if you practice these qualities, you will never fall. For in this way, there will be richly provided for you an entrance into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Let's bow our heads and we'll pray. Our dear Heavenly Father, we do ask that you will write these wonderful words deep into our hearts so that we may rejoice in this assurance, and help us therefore diligently to make every effort to practice these qualities and to grow in our joy and usefulness. And all these things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we're going to sing now about the amazing grace which lies behind everything that we've been thinking about just now. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. We'll sing together.
Thank you.
Please be seated. Well, this evening it is with that great joy that we welcome into membership of our congregation here quite a large number of folk who are shortly going to come and stand in front of you here so that you can see them all and you can hear them confess their faith in Jesus Christ. And the elders, the leaders of our congregation, being satisfied with their Christian knowledge and profession, we're glad to give them this opportunity this evening to express that faith publicly and to take solemn vows before God and before all of us here, committing themselves to love Him and to serve the Lord Jesus Christ at one with the believers of this church, with this tangible congregation here. And it's a large and a diverse group. I think I counted 10 nationalities this evening. We've got people from Scotland, from England, from Ireland, I don't think from Wales, but from Australia, from China, from Japan, from Poland, from Trinidad and Tobago, from Nigeria, and last and certainly not least, from Iran. And if I've missed any out, then I apologize, and I'm sure you'll tell me afterwards. But surely that alone is a testimony, isn't it, to the great gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, because our Lord has promised that there will be those from every tribe, every language, every people, and every nation who belong to His one church, His one people, who are made one in the Lord Jesus Christ. And some here tonight are professing faith publicly for the first time and receiving Christian baptism. Others have previously professed their faith in Christ, have served in other churches elsewhere, but have come here now in Glasgow and are joining with us in this fellowship. But as I said, there'll be a number of baptisms, so let me say a word to explain what that means. The sacrament of baptism was instituted by the Lord Jesus Christ Himself after He had risen from the dead and just before He ascended to the glory of heaven, to the right hand of the Father. The risen Lord said this, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to Me. So you, therefore, My followers, you go and make disciples from all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." So this is something done by the followers of the Lord Jesus, by the Church of Jesus Christ, in obedience to His call and in answer to His command. Now, what Jesus was speaking about there in calling disciples from all nations and baptizing them into His name, it was to fulfill the words of the prophets, their promises of old, because they had foretold a day when through God's Messiah, through the Christ, God would do a new thing at last on this earth. He would establish a new covenant, an everlasting covenant, that would draw all people, not only any longer just chiefly from among the Jews, the people of Israel, although there were always others being added to the covenant throughout the old days. But now, after the coming of the Lord Jesus, a new era, a new age, a new scope, a new openness, a new largesse to the grace of God through Christ, so that the gospel would go to the ends of the earth, calling every tribe and tongue and nation to rejoice along with those who believed from, yes, the natural seed of Israel, the seed of Abraham, but all together with these becoming part of the true Israel of God, one people cleansed, renewed by the grace of God in the gospel of Jesus Christ, His Son. So the words of the prophets were being fulfilled. Ezekiel spoke of that day. In that day he said, "I will sprinkle clean water on you, says the Lord, and you will be clean. I will give you a new heart and a new spirit I'll put within you. and I will cause you to walk in my statutes. And so this sign of baptism is a sign, it's a seal of the fulfillment long promised, but now fulfilled in the climax of God's great covenant of grace in the triumph of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's a sign then of the engrafting of human beings, of all peoples, into the one family of God through Jesus Christ. It's a sign vividly speaking of the forgiveness of sins by the sprinkled blood, no longer just of sacrifices of animals from the altar, but by the one that all these sacrifices pointed to, the blood of the Lord Jesus himself. It speaks of the regeneration, the rebirth, through the pouring out from heaven of his Holy Spirit upon all flesh who believe in the gospel of Jesus. It's a sign of the adoption of all these who believe into the family of the Lord Jesus himself and into the promise of resurrection to everlasting life. And that is, Christian baptism, as we now practice it, it testifies that all the repetitive cleansings, all the repeated washings, all the endless sprinklings of the Old Testament era with all its sacrifices, all its ceremonies, all its temple worship, that has at last come to an end, fulfilled in the one great everlasting sacrifice of Jesus Christ on the cross. The apostle says in Hebrews chapter 9, when Christ appeared, he entered once for all into the holy places, not by the means of the blood of goats and calves, but by means of his own blood, thus securing an eternal redemption. For if the sprinkling of defiled persons by the blood of goats and bulls sanctifies for the purifying of the flesh, how much more will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without blemish to God, how much more will he purify our conscience from dead works to the living God? And so the Apostle Peter, whose second letter we've been reading this evening, he says in his first letter that baptism now saves you. Not as a removal of dirt from the body, but as an appeal to God for a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God. That is, baptism is not our appeal to God, but it points us to Christ's appeal to God on our behalf through his risen presence in the glory of heaven. And so baptism preaches to us in a vivid and visible way. It preaches to us the true gospel of God's grace. It says to us that everything that God promised in the old covenant days has at last come to fulfillment, that it has been fulfilled once and for all in the finished work of Christ. And it's a visible word, therefore, to remind us that it is in Christ and in Christ alone that all our hope is found. Nothing else is needed. No ceremonies, no sacrifices, no washings, no mantras. Just the grace of God poured out to us in Jesus Christ, his beloved Son. And that's what the sign of this water poured out upon the heads of those who are baptized is all about. It points us to the pouring out of the love of God in the cross of Jesus Christ, the pouring out of his own blood for our sins, the sprinkling of our lives with his blood that cleanses us, and the washing that brings us new birth and new life. And so there are a number who are going to come and be baptized this evening, I think 22 in all. And so I'm going to ask them to come to the front here in two groups and baptize them and do it that way. And I'm going to ask them to come out one by one. First of all, Finlay Dougal. Finlay's a student with us in engineering at Strathclyde University. Finlay, come out and stand here. I'll come down and join you. And then Amy McClure, who is at school here in Glasgow. Amy, come and join Finlay here. Then we have a number of Iranian brothers and sisters from our Farsi congregation. And Saeed is going to help me here, but Parisa, come and join us here. And then Shima is not here with us this evening, but Sumai Raji. And then Amadi. And then Reza Amadi. And then Ashkan. And then Amir. And then Bahram. And then Kasra. And then Musen. And then Hadayat. Now, brothers and sisters, we're going to put these questions to you, first in English and then in Farsi. Do you confess your faith in God as your Heavenly Father and in Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord and in the Holy Spirit as your Sanctifier?
آیا به خدای یگانه، پدر، پسر و روح القدس باور دارید و شهادت می دهید که عیسی مسیح سرور و نجات دهنده شماست؟
And do you repent of your sins with a humble and contrite heart and put your trust in the mercy of God which is in Jesus Christ and Him alone?
آیا تعهد می دهید که به صورت مرتب برای عبادت کردن با دیگران دیگر یاران مسیحی خود در روزهای خداوند در کلیسا حاضر شوید؟
And would you kneel down where you stand there? Amy, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. The blessing of God Almighty be upon you and remain with you all the days of your life. Finlay, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. The blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest upon you and remain with you always. I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. The blessing of God Almighty be upon you and remain with you always. So I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. The blessing of God Almighty rest upon you and remain with you all the days of your life. Might I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. The blessing of God Almighty rest upon you and remain with you all the days of your life. Mighty, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. The blessing of God Almighty rest upon you and remain with you all the days of your life. Ashkan, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. The blessing of God Almighty rest upon you and remain with you all the days of your life. Amir, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. The blessing of God Almighty rest upon you and remain with you all the days of your life. Akram, I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. And the blessing of God Almighty rest upon you and remain with you all the days of your life. Kizra, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And the blessing of God Almighty rest upon you and remain with you all the days of your life. Mazen, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. The blessing of God Almighty rest upon you and remain with you all the days of your life. Hadayat, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. The blessing of God Almighty rest upon you and remain with you all the days of your lives. Do stand. Brothers and sisters, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.
در خواهر عزیز خدا بهتون برکت بده و بهتون آرامش بده و امیدواریم که با این قصد تعمیدی که میگیرین روح مقدس خداوند همیشه در کنار شما باشه.
Now if you'd like to just stand back a little bit and coming to join us our Omid and Yara and Dilzar and Amir and Amir Payamani and Farooq and Morteza and Mohammed and then Godrat and Puya. Now, brothers, let me ask you, do you confess your faith in God as your heavenly Father, and in Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord, and in the Holy Spirit as your sanctifier?
برادر عزیز، آیا به خدای یگانه، پدر، پسر و روح القدس باور دارید و شهادت می دهید که عیسی مسیح سرور و نجات دهنده شماست؟
And do you repent of your sins with a humble and contrite heart? And put your trust in the mercy of God, which is in Jesus Christ alone.
و آیا تعهد می دهید که به صورت مرتب برای عبادت کردن با دیگر یاران مسیحی خود در روزهای خداوند در کلیسا حاضر شوید و به خداوند توکل داشته باشید؟
Please kneel.
خواهش می‌کنم بفرمایید زانو بزنید مثل گروه قبل.
And with great joy, I baptize you. Omid, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son. And of the Holy Spirit, the blessing of God Almighty rest upon you and remain with you all the days of your lives. I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Spirit, and the blessing of God Almighty rest upon you and remain with you all the days of your life. Dozar, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit remain with you all the days of your life. Amir, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and may the blessing of God Almighty rest upon you and remain with you all the days of your life. Amir, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. The blessing of God Almighty rest upon you and remain with you all your life long. Farooq, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. The blessing of God Almighty rest upon you and remain with you all the days of your life. Morteza, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. The blessing of God Almighty rest upon you and remain with you all the days of your life. Mohammed, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And the blessing of God Almighty rest upon you and remain with you all the days of your life. Godrat, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. The blessing of God Almighty rest upon you and remain with you all the days of your life. Puya, I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. And the blessing of God Almighty rest upon you and remain with you all the days of your life. Amen. Please stand. Brothers in Christ, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.
برادرای عزیز، دوستای گرامی که تعمید گرفتن، خداوند بهتون برکت بده و آرامشش رو همراه روح القدسش در کنار شما تا ابد داشته باشه. آمین.
Now alongside our brothers and sisters who have confessed their faith and been baptized before us here this evening, there are a number of others who are going to be joining our fellowship and committing themselves to serve the Lord now here in this church alongside us. I'm going to ask them to come and stand alongside me here, and then I will ask all who are joining the fellowship to answer the vows that we put to them. Tamunabim is from Nigeria and is a nurse and is studying for a master's here in Glasgow, and we welcome you this evening. We also welcome Ed and Alice Cox to membership. They're away this weekend, but they're welcomed among us nonetheless in absentia. But Ash Cunningham is here. Ash works for UCCF, and Ash, we welcome you this evening also into the fellowship. Lee Dong is from China and was baptized here some years ago, went back to China, and has come back to study further in Glasgow. And Lee, we're delighted that you're coming to join us here in the fellowship. From Japan is Matthew Ferguson. And as many of us know, Matthew's not with us this evening because he's back with his family in Japan, where his father is very seriously, indeed terminally ill. And we welcome Matthew most warmly into the membership of our fellowship, and we assure him and his family of our prayers at this time, as his father David, who is a key worker with OMF in Japan, is suffering very seriously from cancer. But we welcome Matthew nonetheless very, very warmly, and we look forward to his return among us in due course. Then Adam and Rosemary Hannah have recently joined us. Adam's a retired GP and Rosemary a nurse. And it's a marriage of Scotland and Ireland, so we're very Celtic across here. Welcome. Then James Hogg has been with us for some time. Come and join us, Jim. And is a faithful member also of the Tronet 2 congregation. You're very welcome, brother. Then Mervyn and Rosie McClure are Amy's grandparents and Simon's parents. And they've moved up recently to join the family here in Glasgow, from the south of England, and we welcome you very warmly as well. Then Agnes. Agnes is from Glasgow, Agnes O'Donnell, and we're delighted, Agnes, that having been with us for a while here in the church, you're joining the fellowship tonight as well. Then Anna is from Poland, and we welcome you, Anna, very warmly into the fellowship of the church here. And Candace is from Trinidad and Tobago, and she came here because she wanted some good weather. And we welcome you, Candace, very warmly into the Glasgow weather. Gordon Rogers is a retired teacher, and he is more of a local man. And Gordon, we're delighted to welcome you this evening. And then last but not least, Sherry, who comes from China and is here in Glasgow studying for a PhD in ocean engineering or some other such exciting thing that's beyond my understanding. Well, 10 nations, maybe more, I may have miscounted, but all one in Jesus Christ. And that's the gospel that alone can draw together people of such different ages, backgrounds, nations, and situations. But that's what the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ has been doing from the very beginning and will do all the more throughout this world until he comes again. And so, as our brothers and sisters join us this evening, I'm going to put to them questions which I think all of you have in English or in Farsi in the sheet that you received this evening. And every one of us who's a member of this congregation has answered these questions in the affirmative. And so, in a sense, for all of us this evening, whether we're taking these vows for the first time or whether we've heard them repeated many, many times, it's a reaffirmation of what every one of us here stands for and promises before God. And so as I put these questions to our new members here, I'm going to ask all of us to stand so that we can remind ourselves that we also are all part of this. So let me ask you, and again we'll have English and then Farsi. Do you believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord?
آیا به خدای یگانه، پدر، پسر و روح القدس باور دارید و شهادت می دهید که عیسی مسیح سرور و نجات دهنده شماست؟
Do you promise then to join regularly with your fellow Christians here in worship on the Lord's day?
آیا تعهد می دهید که به صورت مرتب برای عبادت کردن با دیگر یاران مسیحی خود در روزهای خداوند به کلیسا حاضر شوید؟
Do you promise to be faithful in reading the Bible and in prayer?
آیا تعهد می دهید در خواندن کتاب مقدس و دعا کردن وفادار باشید؟
And do you promise to give a fitting proportion of your time, talents and money for this church's work in the world?
آیا تعهد می دهید که بخش مناسبی از وقت، استعداد و پول خود را در راه خدمات کلیسا در جهان مصرف کنید؟
And do you promise then, depending on the grace of God, to confess Christ before men and to serve him in your daily work and to walk in his ways all the days of your lives?
آیا تعهد می دهید که با توکل به یاری خداوند عیسی مسیح را در مقابل دیگران شهادت بدهید و به او در زندگی روزانه خود خدمت کنید و همواره در مسیر او قدم بردارید؟
Well, then the Lord bless you and enable you faithfully to keep your promises. And the God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory, confirm you by his Spirit that you may be indeed established in his covenant and to be found blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. As we stand, let's pray. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. Those who belong to Jesus Christ have crucified the sinful nature with its passions and desires. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. If anyone would come after me, said the Lord Jesus, he must deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for me and for the gospel will save it. So, Lord, we pray that you would help our brothers and sisters here tonight and every one of us who professes to be a follower of Jesus Christ. Help us to be faithful and fruitful in all that we have promised for the sake of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. So in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, the only King and the only head of this or any church, and by the authority of the elders of our congregation, we admit these brothers and sisters into membership in our fellowship here, to the fellowship of the Lord's table, to the fellowship of his people, and to serve alongside all of us in the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. And the Lord says to all of us, hate what is evil, cling to what is good, never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, and faithful in prayer. And so as we stand, we close our service by singing our final hymn of response. O Jesus, we have promised to serve you to the end. Finally, brothers, rejoice. Aim for restoration. Comfort one another. Agree with one another. Live in peace. And the God of love and peace will be with you. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, guard your heart and your minds in Christ Jesus. And God will supply every need of yours according to his riches in glory in Christ Jesus. To our God and Father be glory forever and ever. Amen.